Now, we're going to look at this first just based on a neurobiological perspective on how can we get in and have an impact on anxiety from a brain-based perspective.
Okay. Now, with normal fight or flight responses, there's an external threat, and this is processed. Whoops.
I'm out of control here. It's learned helplessness. Okay, here we go.
Processed to two parts of the brain, the cortex doing conscious level, more snazzy, complex information processing, and the level of the amygdala.
Okay, and the amygdala engages in unconscious threat appraisal. And the two of these, independent of one another, can ignite a fight or flight response. Now, the amygdala does crude pattern recognition. It senses something that might be dangerous and can set off anxiety, okay? The cortex can do much better reality testing and get clear about, wait a minute, is this dangerous or not, okay? But oftentimes in our patients, these two parts of the brain are not coming up with the same conclusions, okay? You may, and in fact, you tend to get a lot of false alarms with the amygdala. Now, let's say you're just a pharmacologist and you don't care about psychotherapy. You're just looking at this from a biological perspective. What you could do is you could say, okay, what we could do is we could intervene here at the level of threat appraisal. And one way to do that is do something that reduces the excitability level in the amygdala. And you can manipulate the threshold for perceiving danger at the level of the amygdala in several ways, okay? One way to do that is to give a central nervous system depressant. And this is alcohol, this could be tranquilizers, okay, this could be barbiturates. Now, what this will do is it'll put the whole brain to sleep, but a lot of people, this is their own homemade pharmacologic treatment, especially for social anxiety disorder. People go to a party and they feel nervous and they have a drink or two and they're less anxious, okay? So part of what's happening is you're reducing the threshold for perceiving potential danger in the environment because there are receptors in the amygdala that are responsive to tranquilizers, to alcohol, and to barbiturates. All right? So that's one approach. The downside is it puts your whole brain into a state of depression and you can get arrested. You can kill people in a drunk driving accident. If you happen to be taking a licensing exam and you know you're feeling really nervous, take 4 milligrams of Xanax, you won't feel very anxious, but your cortex doesn't work. You know, and a lot of times during the licensing exam, you have to use your cortex. Okay? At least that's what I'm told. Okay, but that's one approach. Okay, the second approach is you can smoke marijuana. I don't recommend that because I don't want to lose my license. Okay, but it turns out that one of the major type of inhibitory receptors in the amygdala are cannabinoid receptors. And there's two groups of patients that tend to really gravitate towards the use of cannabis to treat anxiety and to help them sleep. Now, many people can do this, but the two groups are people that have borderline personality disorder and that have bipolar disorder. And I have had numerous patients, especially in these two categories, who eventually will say, you know what, I'm smoking pot. I had this one lady, she had borderline personality, very severe, and she came to me. The doctor said, if she doesn't get treatment, she's probably going to be dead in 6 months because she's starting to have signs of liver failure, and that was because she was drinking a case of beer every night. And so anyway, and she was a tough case. I saw her for many years, and she ultimately did very, very well. Not for a while, okay, but she had gotten down to drinking a six-pack at night, which was substantially less. And she came in to me one day, and she said, you know, this may be 6 months into treatment, she said, I got to tell you something, and that is I'm smoking a little dope. You know, I don't, what do you think about that? And again, not wanting to lose my license, you know, I had to tread very carefully. But I know that in people that are so, you know, neurobiologically dysregulated anyway, you know, that lots of borderline people use marijuana. And I said, well, some people use it, but there are potential problems with marijuana as well. She says, well, look, let me put it to you like this, John. If I were going to go home tonight and drink a six-pack of beer or take a couple of, hits off of, marijuana, what would you recommend? And I said, I would recommend that you not drink the alcohol. Okay. So what's very interesting here is this has opened up a window of opportunity for drug companies to try to develop drugs that do not have the adverse effects of marijuana, but are selective cannabinoid receptor agonists that turn this on. And if they can find that, then maybe we have, a new source of drugs for treating anxiety disorders. Okay. Now, the third thing you can do is you can increase serotonin levels. And serotonin levels are going to have an impact on on how metabolically active the amygdala is. And it's primarily by increasing serotonergic activity in the frontal lobes that come in and dampen the amygdala. Okay, so again, just looking at this from a simple biological perspective then, those are several different approaches, all right? At the level of threat appraisal.